Hi, good afternoon, and welcome to today's webinar. Today's webinar, we're going to go over third-party efficiency financing and tackle the questions what, why, when, and how. My name is Dave Jaros. I run marketing here at Noesis, and I'm joined today by two of my colleagues. Tiana Palumbo-Price is here. She's a senior manager in the marketing department, and she has spent several years before Noesis working with demand-side programs in specifically in New York City, and actually tackled a lot of these problems on behalf of the folks that she was working with in terms of trying to get projects done and trying to source the financing to fund those projects. And so she knows firsthand about some of the complexities and some of the problems when people go out and try to seek third-party financing. So she's going to offer her first-hand experiences on what she saw in the market. And then Ahai Broner, who's here with us as well. He's a project specialist here at Noesis. And Ahai wears two hats. He wears the project analysis hat, and so he's trained as an energy manager as well as a financing hat, and so knows really the ins and outs for finding efficiency financing on projects. And so he's going to share his insights as he works with project developers and building owners on project financing to really shed some light on what he sees firsthand when he's talking to building owners, lenders, and project developers. So what we're going to do is I'll give a quick overview of who Noesis is, and then we're going to jump right into it. Again, we're going to talk about what is efficiency financing, why should you include it, when you should introduce it into the sales cycle, and then how do you access it and how do you include it in your proposals. At the end, I'll talk briefly about what we offer here at Noesis through Noesis Financing Services, and then at the end, we'll open it up for Q&A. As always, please use the GoToWebinar console to type in your questions. We will answer as many as we can at the back end of the webinar. If we don't get to all of them, we, as a rule, we take all the questions, we answer them. We create a PDF, and then we'll email that out to all of the folks who attended. So again, if you don't hear your question answered, or you want to see the answers to the other questions that were asked, we're going to provide that out to you. It's usually a few days after the webinar, which gives us some time to make sure that we answer all the questions. So who is Noesis? You know, kind of in simple words, what we are is a financial marketplace where we use our financial services expertise, our syndicate of financing lenders, and then our online sales tools to really help commercial, industrial, energy efficiency companies do more projects. And so the way that they do more projects is, not surprisingly, is getting more of those projects approved. And so with our tools and our services, we not only allow them to propose more and do better business cases for their proposals, but we're also adding in the third-party financing for their projects to overcome those budget obstacles. In terms of who our customers are, kind of the general description is any company that sells efficiency services and products into commercial industrial building owners. Those are typically who we sell our services to, or who sign up with us to use our services to sell into the building owners. On the right-hand side there are just some of the accounts, companies that are using us. Some real familiar names up there. Obviously Trane, people recognize. We're actually used by the PG&E Trade Professional Alliance, so the network of contractors that work within PG&E's region. They get access to our tools to attach financing to their deals. And then some of the other ones you can see there on the right side there. To date, we have over 110 companies out there in the U.S. who are using Noesis to add financing to all of their energy efficiency proposals. So let's jump right in. So what is third-party financing? So what I'll do during this webinar is I'll sort of introduce some basic concepts as we go through the four questions, and then I'll hand it off to Tiana and to AHAI, again, to provide their real-life experiences to, again, provide some more color and context for you about how things are going in the real world. So what is third-party efficiency financing? It is what it sounds like. It's just financing for these projects. But what a lot of people don't realize is that there are a lot of different forms of financing. Some people think it's maybe just a bank loan, but there's a lot of different ways that you can actually acquire the financing to purchase energy efficiency equipment. State local programs. So there's a lot of money that is dedicated to subsidizing some of these efficiency upgrades. Obviously, bank loans. If you have a credit facility, a credit line at a bank, you can use that. Financing agreements are also used. Leases. A lot of people don't realize that that equipment leases, the same leases that you use for leasing fleet vehicles, can be used to lease efficiency equipment. They could be operating leases or capital leases, and then municipal leases as well if you qualify for that. Performance contracts, that seems to get a lot of the buzz in the space. These tend to be pretty large, pretty heavyweight, where savings are oftentimes guaranteed or they're shared. They tend to be, again, larger deals, multi-million-dollar deals, where the contractor will really take on ownership of basically the energy efficiency for a particular company or portfolio of buildings. And so a lot of folks are familiar with what the ESCOs are doing out there in performance contracts. And then there's the things like PACE, which is really popping up and getting popular all over the U.S., and then on-bill financing, which is offered by utilities where they can actually fund the projects and then have them paid by a line item on the energy bill. So again, a lot of different flavors of efficiency financing. Not all of them applicable to each case, and so you do need to really understand kind of the nuances of the different vehicles to really know what's right for your particular project. So what does it look like? Again, what is kind of the CFO looking at when you offer third-party financing? Typically, it's zero down. This is something that's important for a lot of CFOs. 100% finance, including soft costs, and so again, no money out of pocket. Building owners like to see cash flow neutral to cash flow positive. They like to see that they're actually going to be making money once this project is installed. Project payback under 6 years. This is typical. Folks that are selling lights out there can see paybacks 2 years, sometimes even less than that. We see kind of the appetite being around 6 years or less. The last two items on this list are things that the CFO or building owner needs to think through before you can decide on a vehicle. For example, the payments, do they want them fixed or do they want them variable? Do they want them based on, say, the performance of the equipment or as measured by energy savings, such that they could be variable? And then the last one is off balance sheet or not. This is typically for larger companies, whether or not they want to use their balance sheet to fund this and actually have the asset on their balance sheet, or if they want to have the asset that is the equipment off their balance sheet. It's something that CFOs and building owners think a lot about, and so oftentimes they'll have a preference whether or not they want it off balance sheet or on. Just a few more thoughts, and then I'll get Taina and AHAI to chime in here. Rebates and incentives, a lot of people use them, and they're great. And they bring down the amount of money to be financed, but they're not to be confused with financing. They're not, when the CFO or building owner is looking for financing, they're not looking for just how much they can get in rebates and incentives. And so rebates and incentives helps, but they're not what's defined as financing. Having cash isn't the same thing as having cash for efficiency projects. This is real important because a lot of project developers that we talk to will say things like, well, I know that building owner has money, and so I don't need to include financing. Or they've never financed in the past, and so they'll budget this and they'll get the cash. And it's really not the same. There are various reasons and drivers for using financing. You know, a lot of those companies have money to go out and purchase fleet vehicles, but instead they lease them. And there's just different reasons why people finance. It's not because they don't have the money. And then financing is not a sign of desperation. And so you may say, well, this company is financially healthy, and so there's no reason why they would finance. It's actually an indication of real smart capital, informed capital allocation. So, you know, they may say, I do have the cash for that, but instead of that cash going for that, I'm going to take the cash and I'm going to, you know, open a European office. I'm going to build a new factory. I'm going to do some other things that are going to help grow the business. And so I can use financing as a way to do both upgrade the equipment as well as grow my business. So with that, what I'd like to do is first kind of hand it over to Taina and just give me your thoughts on kind of what is efficiency financing based on what you've seen out there.
Thanks, Dave. So as Dave mentioned earlier, I spent a lot of the last 5 years working directly on state and utility incentive programs. And during that time, I was really shocked to find how many projects and how many building owners who intend to participate in programs where they might get rebates and incentives eventually fall out. And so just anecdotally, in a lot of the programs that we designed and ran at my last job, we'd have to look for ways to sign up between 3 and 5 times the number of projects that we actually needed in order to end up meeting the goals for the program. So that means, you know, one out of 5 projects would actually count towards actually bringing down the rebate. And so that's 4 out of 5 projects where somebody came to the table, was interested in participating, and then, you know, eventually fell out somewhere along the line. And I think we all kind of know there's a ton of money out there for building owners to tap into to help them fund retrofits. You know, there's federal programs, there's state programs, there's local programs, the utilities have stuff, sometimes manufacturers have stuff. But what I began to realize sort of after a couple of cycles of working on these programs is that incentives are not 100% the reason that somebody would move forward with work. So even if you've got a project that, let's say, is $1 million and there's an incentive or rebate out there that covers 70% of the work, I tend, or at least, you know, the people that I worked with, at least on the utility side, tend to sort of have this idea that a rebate of that size is an incentive enough to move forward on a job, and that anybody who doesn't take advantage sort of doesn't get it. It's a no-brainer. They should do this right now before the funds dry out. But in reality, there's a lot more complexity to making a decision about spending that kind of cash, even if you are going to get a rebate, to do the work. And so I think in reality, although there are a lot of funds out there that people can tap into, the best scenario or the ideal scenario is to be able to give your clients both the sort of general perspective of what rebates and incentives are out there, but also be able to offer them third-party financing as well. And I'll tell you why I think that this is the case. So for a lot of you out there who sell efficiency equipment, you know that unless something in a facility has run and reached the end of its useful life, so a boiler has blown a fuse or, you know, lighting has, you know, been impaired in some way, there isn't a reason, you know, of urgency for somebody to come in and actually replace any part of the equipment in a facility, and that people aren't going to be out there aggressively looking for somebody to retrofit equipment that is still working. There isn't any reason for them to do that. So additionally, and sort of related, if they aren't planning for it, if it hasn't come up as an emergency or isn't, you know, the 15-year mark on a boiler that needs to be replaced every 15 years, people aren't going to be out in the marketplace looking for that, and they aren't going to have the funds earmarked for a large retrofit or energy efficiency project. And sort of insider secret, the truth is that the majority of market rate and incentive programs require for the work to be completed and paid in full before incentive processing can begin. So while during the time at the sale, you know, you're kind of selling and leading with the idea that they're going to only have to pay, let's say, 30% of, you know, $1 million job, in most cases, they have to outlay the $1 million in order to get the work done, and then the rebate comes, you know, a little bit down the line. And so I think the other part of it that folks sort of don't think about is that timeline. You're selling with the idea that the rebate is going to help make the sale, but at some point, if the folks don't have the money in their, you know, sort of reserves and they're not ready to outlay that money, they're going to have to come up with it and be without it for a significant amount of time. So as I was saying, funds have to sort of be distributed after projects are completed, and that is sort of a loaded term. So that means that the work has to be installed, it has to be post-inspected, and on the case of utility rebates, the utility has to deem that the work has passed all of the different criteria and checklists in order for a check to be cut. And there's a lot of administrative red tape that goes into that. And so let's say I've outlaid $1 million and I'm waiting for my $700,000 rebate to come. There is not 100% chance that I'm going to get that money back. If sometime between the time that I've paid the money and the work has been installed, somewhere down the line there's a specification that was messed up or the, you know, the rebates have run out, there is always a slight margin that, that those funds will not get returned to me in whatever way, and I might be out for the full cost of the job even though I wasn't planning to spend that cash. So in those scenarios, I think that being able to combine third-party financing with incentives lets you provide your clients the most flexibility in getting their projects completed. And I think secondly and more importantly, it helps protect them from the risk of delay or minimized or disallowed incentives. Hi, what do you think?
Yeah, thanks, Anna. You know, you make some really good points there with utilities incentives not being a source of financing. They're certainly a source of reducing that first capital cost, but they're not necessarily a source to take care of that all the whole upfront money. And so, you know, once you've got that figured out and you introduce the concept of financing, it's really what kind of financing does your customer need? And so, you know, from kind of the perspective I've been working at lately, and we've just been seeing a lot of really exciting, interesting things happening in the market right now, where traditionally operating leases were very popular and capital leases and kind of traditional financing, and then maybe in the mush markets and some universities, schools, and housing markets where you'd see these large ESCO projects, we're actually starting to see a proliferation of kind of shared savings agreements and performance-based financing vehicles within the space. So along with incentives, we're seeing some very interesting kind of performance vehicles, as well as actually PACE is another type of vehicle, and a plethora of new lenders that are coming into the market and offering some very exciting financing opportunities, you know, including kind of hybrids such as Noesis's new energy performance lease between a capital lease and a performance contract that offers some really good opportunities that make sense within the private sector.
Thanks a lot, Hi. So the second question we want to answer is, why include third-party financing on your project proposals? So for the last couple of years, we've done a survey out to our users and asked them for information about the projects that they do, the proposals that they do, how many proposals they do, what size the proposals, how many get approved, and for those that don't get approved, why don't they get approved? And what we found is that, and this has been consistent for the last couple of years, is around 25% is kind of the average, a percent of projects that get approved. As you can imagine, in there you've got some people that get a lot of their projects approved, but you also have a lot of folks in there that are getting, you know, 10-15% of their projects approved, which is a pretty low yield considering all the effort that that you put into those proposals. And so when we asked why those projects weren't getting approved, the number one reason cited by 59% of the people was that they're just not budgeted. And so this you know, it shouldn't come as a surprise that so many of these things aren't budgeted, because oftentimes these projects are proposed fairly opportunistically. They're not replacements for, say, a broken chiller, but it is an opportunity to invest in a new chiller that's going to have savings that will offset the costs. And so, you know, a lot of these things are unplanned, and as a consequence, they're unbudgeted. And so when so many people out there know that the budget is the main reason why they don't get their projects approved,
one would think that it would be natural to simply include third-party financing on the proposals to make sure that they could overcome that budget obstacle. But when we asked, you know, do you include options for third-party financing, you know, sometimes and never were the predominant answers. 12% said always, I always include third-party financing on the proposals. And, you know, when you kind of have that disconnect between they know budget's the problem, but they're not including financing, the question then is, well, why not? And almost 80% of the people said they just didn't know enough about it or didn't have time to include it. And, you know, what that means is that there's just, you know, as we know, and specifically we who work at Noesis, because we deal with this on a day-to-day basis, efficiency financing is complicated. It's and it's not just to go out and talk to a lender and know that you can get a lease or a loan. It's then sitting down with the CFO or the building owner and actually explaining it. And that is probably the most daunting task that a project developer would have to do. And so oftentimes people just don't include it because they're just not comfortable with their ability to go out and find the right financing vehicle and then present it to the CFO. But if you choose to take that route and not include it because you're not comfortable with it, or you don't have the time to go learn about it and include it, what you should realize, if you don't already realize, is that the bigger players out there, they're including financing on every deal. And so you know who the big guys are out there, the national, international folks. These guys have teams of financing experts who attach financing to all their proposals and make sure that they make it very easy for the building owner to say yes. And so if you choose not to include it, you're at a clear disadvantage from the very outset. And so we believe that you should include financing on every deal. Taina, what do you think about the thoughts on why should someone include financing on their project proposals?
Yeah, so Dave, from my experience, lack of funding is the number one reason that projects stall out and die. And as I mentioned earlier, or at least I alluded to it, I think so many projects never reach completion that when people are designing incentive and rebate programs, they have to sort of accommodate for these issues. And I think, yeah, I did mention this, but they sometimes have to enroll up to as many as 5 times of the projects necessary in order to meet program goals just to make up for all the projects that never get completed. And unfortunately, in these scenarios, having a motivated building owner or manager is just not enough always to get projects over the finish line. Most of the business models I've been involved with leave the financing discussion for the very end of the project lifecycle. And as I talk to folks here at Noesis and I get feedback from the different initiatives that we engage in, a lot of people tell me that that's sort of still true for them. It's the traditional engineering model of selling efficiency work. And in this model, lack of funding only comes up way after a fully baked audit and a proposed scope have been submitted to the customer. And in most cases, they've tried to run it up the flagpole a couple of ways. They've gotten denied, and that's sort of when it rolls back down to the people that are selling the project that there isn't any funds for it. And just to unpack that a little bit, at least in my experience, what I've seen is that it means that a site visit, including sometimes data collection, building modeling using software, specifications, which technically are traditionally done by an engineer, and then a proposal development, writing the proposal, laying it out, formatting it, having people review it, all of that stuff takes place, all of those hours of work and dollars spent take place before typically you know whether an owner can pay for the work or has any intention of looking for funds to pay for the work. And I think a lot of us have probably been involved in what happens next is just this very painful extended negotiation process and this is sort of where your client turns around and tries to sell the proposal that you've developed internally and tries to kind of figure out ways to maneuver to get funds allocated in order to do the work. What's really scary about this is that after you've outlaid all of this time and effort in preparing the proposal, spent all this staff resources and time and energy, the part where the sale really happens internally is completely out of your control. And traditionally, even if you're working with somebody on staff who's really motivated, this is where the momentum for the project really begins to halt. And just like a little bird's eye view, what's happening is the building owner who doesn't already have project funds, or the facility manager, whoever it is that you're working with on a building level, is going to their financial manager and asking for funds to cover a project that they think is going to save a lot of energy. Maybe they're talking about the financial savings, maybe they're not, but they've got sort of this great big idea of this project that we can engage in. And while they see a huge opportunity, what their financial manager or CFO is hearing is that they need to outlay a bunch of cash for a project that they haven't sort of pre-approved, it's not in the budget, that they may have to spend their reserves, their cash on hand, in order to make that happen. And sometimes they don't have the money on hand, and when they do, they often don't want to just spend it on a project that hasn't sort of been in the works for a long time and has not been sort of discussed over and over again as part of the sort of the business model for the year. And so typically what happens next, at least in my experience, is after your advocate has sort of gone in and tried to sell internally, that they come back to you and they say they don't have money to do the project. And that's sort of a very tricky place to be, because you haven't discussed with them from the beginning whether or not they have funds on hand, or they've discussed how the project would be funded. But then you're additionally at a disadvantage at that point, because the next step is for you to either let the project die because you don't have a way to sort of help them get the funds that they need, or you have to step in and sort of play the role of the financial advisor to help connect them to the funding that they need. And a lot of times it's too late, because the CFO has already passed up on the opportunity, and they're not going to be really willing to re-review this project that they've sort of declined, even if you do have really compelling financing attached to it. So for all intents and purposes, unless a miracle happens, when a client comes back to you and says that they don't have funds to do the project, it's traditionally a no, and it means that you have to sort of chalk up the loss to all the hours that you spent developing that project and move on to the next thing, hoping that it will close. Ahai, why do you think that including third-party financing is so important on energy efficiency projects?
Well, I think you make some very excellent points in the fact that it helps kind of bridge that the funding and the budget issues. But there's actually another very important reason that's not traditionally talked about very often, and that's credibility. So when you bring financing in, you may or may not know this, but finance lenders are extremely risk averse and don't like to not get their money back. So they tend to invest in very sure types of products and very things that they're very confident in. And so when you bring financing to the table and you're showing your customers financing up front, what you're really telling them is there's somebody else in the financial industry who's looked at this and who's feels comfortable with the technology and feels comfortable with the financial analysis behind this project, that they're willing to put their money behind it. So when it goes to the CFO of the organization, of your customer, he knows he's not the only one looking at this, and that he's got some backup, and that there's credibility behind this project. So beyond just that first cost issue and bringing funds and bridging the gap of no budget, that's actually another very important aspect of just building credibility with your client.
Yeah, thanks, Ahai. And it's a good point that's worth repeating, because when we talked about in the beginning, people who think that their customer is going to self-fund, just bringing in the analysis that another lender, another financial expert has looked at and decided to loan money against, even if they choose to self-fund, it allows them to the peace of mind knowing that someone else looked at it through the financial lens and came to the same conclusion that the CFO is coming to. So again, it's a great point. So when introduce third-party financing, if you kind of look at the phases, and I'm oversimplifying this, but the phases of a sale, being from your estimate or just kind of getting interest in the project to the formal proposal where you've got the audit and all the other engineering documents that kind of get wrapped around that, and then there's a there's a decision to move forward, and then there's the negotiation where you start getting the lawyers and the contracts involved. And then there's obviously the dead or the shelved or the stalled or the pushed out stage. I mean, we at Noesis think you should really introduce third-party financing as early in the process as possible for a variety of reasons. You know, start the discussion, figure out if you have a chance at getting this thing or finding the money for this project. It also is a good way to you know, kind of like see if there's a real appetite for the project. And so there might be an appetite at the facility level, but you don't want to wait until, say, the negotiation stage to find out that the financial decision maker is not interested in this project at all. And so by including it early on, that financial decision maker is going to be brought into the discussion a lot earlier. So again, here at Noesis, we recommend that you introduce third-party financing as early in the process as possible. And the other thing about when to include it, not only the stage of the sales cycle, but also, you know, how often. And we recommend really that you do it on every deal. And, you know, just getting back to what we talked about earlier, you may think you know what route the building owner wants to take, whether it's self-funding or using their own credit line, but you may not. And so it's always safer to simply include it on every deal, and that way it provides the opportunity for any building owner, whatever situation they're in, to use financing if they need it or if they want it. So don't assume you know what the building owner wants to do, because again, there's a bunch of different reasons why someone may choose to finance versus using their own capital. Taina, what are your sort of thoughts on kind of when is the best time to introduce financing into a sales cycle?
Well, Dave, I totally agree with what you were just sort of describing. Getting the financing discussion going as early in the collaboration with your clients is the absolute ideal scenario. It saves you time, as I referenced earlier, and can avert some, you know, can avert having put a lot of time and effort into a project, knowing early on whether or not somebody is even interested in engaging around financing. But I'd say, sort of on the other side of the coin, that it's never too late to introduce financing into a deal. The bottom line is you really don't have anything to lose, particularly if you've already gone out there and proposed some work and, you know, for whatever reason they've come back and don't have the funds to do the project. Like I said, I think you'll save yourself a lot of resources and time if your client isn't able to identify how they'll fund a project. In a perfect world, I think everyone can tweak their proposal process to take on financing early in the conversation on every project. But for the folks who are on the line with us here today, I'd say even if a project has passed the sort of initial discovery phase where you would ideally introduce financing, you can still introduce it. I think you can revive a project with financing options wherever you are sort of in the project life cycle. And in my experience, even projects that appear to be dead for many moons can have new life breathed into them when financing options come and sort of are available. I've seen significant increases in project adoption and completion from seemingly dead projects. And I've seen some that have been dormant for 18 months when a larger incentive comes to play or when new financing opportunities come along. And a great example of that is on-bill financing, which is something that a lot of utilities are dealing with right now. Just as an example, this is sort of a non-CNI example, but in residential on-bill financing, a lot of people passed up on work for many years with the utility that I worked on programs for in New York. And when on-bill financing came to bear and there was a financing option, so many projects that, you know, we tried over and over again to get off the ground ended up getting started because of this new financing option. And I saw the same thing on the CNI side when larger incentives came to pass for, you know, common technologies like lighting or like boiler retrofits. I described earlier sort of that awkward conversation that takes place between you, between your client and their financial manager that can lead to that sort of objection of no funds. And I think the introduction of third-party financing at any stage in the game helps alleviate the pressure on the building owner and also on their CFO, which is probably something that most of us don't think of. It gives the CFO the option to really assess whether they can take on a project from the beginning and not have to use the financial excuse as the reason that the project doesn't get funded. So I think a lot of times, and as I talk to people out there in our community, the lack of funds objection to projects is a catch-all for a lot of different things. It has to do with trust, it has to do with timing, it has to do with the importance of that project in the business that's happening at the time that it's proposed. But when a financial decision maker has an option to buy and a pathway to purchase, I think it makes it a little bit of an easier conversation. They can give you some real specifics about why a project can't move forward that don't tie into that if the answer is no. And they can also sort of be alleviated from having to go out and find funds or move things around or make budget, because that's another stress and strain on them that would often have them sort of push something off for a while because they don't have the time or resources to go and look for the cash. Hi, when do you think the best time to introduce financing is?
So my favorite time is early and often. So I think the best time is it's right when you're starting the conversation, mostly because you need to get your customers prepped and let them know and understand that there's cash at the end of this if they need. You know, there's financing at the end. They don't have to come up with the money. And so that gives them time to kind of weigh their options and figure it out. And so it really sets the tone of the conversation. But beyond just getting them prepped, one of the things I really like about bringing the conversation early on is you start moving away from what I call kind of the tyranny of simple payback. And we've all run into this to the industry, especially in the commercial and industrial space, where you see these ridiculously low kind of hurdle rates of a 2-year simple payback and maybe if they're really farsighted, a 3-year simple payback. And as we all well know, simple payback is a terrible financial metric. It's really not a financial metric. It's a risk metric. But that's what they set because that's what they know and they understand. But when you bring in a cash flow chart and you show them it's positive from day one, they start to think about the long-term benefits of the project. They start to understand that it's not just today's cost and today's savings, that this project's going to be there for a while. And, well, hey, not only am I going to get savings over, 10, 15 years, I'm going to get money in my pocket from day one when it's cash flow positive. So, wow, it really makes sense for me to finance this. And then oftentimes they say, well, if it makes sense for me to finance this, well, then I can actually go ahead and purchase it myself. And so you'll see positive benefits from showing financing, whether they do self-funding or do financing. So it really kind of, I can show a project with a 4-year simple payback that's cash flow positive and can save a customer $1 million. They don't care if it's not a 2-year payback at that point. They care that it's saving them money. And so you can really start to have that conversation with the higher level, the CFO and kind of the C-suite to make sure that they understand they don't really care about the technology. They care about what money's going in their pocket.
Great, thanks, Ahai. And the fourth question that we want to ask is hopefully at this point we've convinced you that including financing is important for a variety of reasons. So the question that is probably on the tip of your tongues, which is how then can you include third-party financing on all of your project proposals? And there's really three ways that you can do it. If you're big enough, if you're one of the large international efficiency equipment companies, you probably have your own financing help desk and team that you can call on to make sure that you've got the right information for all your proposals. A lot of people don't have that. A lot of the companies that at least we work with are smaller, regional, and they don't have the luxury of having that. So again, if you have it, great. If you don't, you're probably looking at numbers 2 or 3. So number 2 is find and negotiate with lenders, and this is you go out and you find a leasing company, you work with your local bank to put together the packages. And while it sounds simple, it really can get kind of messy in that sometimes people don't want to lease. Sometimes they want to do something more exotic. Sometimes they want to look into PACE. Sometimes they may want an energy services agreement. And so you can choose and go talk to one lender, but that one lender is going to have rules around the size of project that they want to look at, the types of companies, the types of projects, the types of vehicles that they offer. And so it's really hard to go out and actually find all the different lenders offering all the different the vehicles for all the different technologies and project sizes. So again, you can do that, and on a one-off basis, it might be something that's doable. But for a business that's doing a lot of proposals, it's really not a good option. And then the third one is use a third party for financial services. And again, this is, you know, most people on this call know. I mean, this is what Noesis offers. We're not the only one that does this. And so what this allows you to do is get one person to go to who can go and kind of do all the heavy lifting for you and all the kind of work behind the scenes to put together the right packages. And the other thing that this does for you is it provides you with a person who can not only give you the estimates or the quotes for your proposal, but can also early on with you at their side start having that financial discussion with the building owner or CFO. And so it's not on you to go and present the intricacies of the different efficiency financing options, but that third party should do that with you. They should be at your side, selling the CFO while you are selling the facility team and the engineers on the technology. So again, those are really the three options that you have to attach third-party financing to your efficiency proposals. Taina, just I mean, when you were out in the field and up in New York and working with all those contractors, how did those folks attach financing to their proposals?
Well, so in all candor, I'm coming from the world of folks with no internal finance department, and as I mentioned earlier, mostly folks that were not introducing financing until the very end of a project cycle. So for the folks on the line, I even get a little bit of agita when I think about the idea of sitting down with the building owners that I previously worked with and trying to begin discussing financing with them, you know, before we've really gone out and done an audit. I think for a lot of people who have been working sort of in the old traditional model of audit first and sort of negotiation and discussion second, it feels a little bit intrusive. It feels like you're kind of getting in somebody's face and talking to them about things that are kind of private, but that's not really the case. However, I do know that it is a scary idea, and even when it is after you've gone out and done an audit and have some real substantive idea of what needs to happen in a facility, talking about the money is the single scariest part in the project lifecycle for somebody who is not apt and, you know, conditioned to do that. And like I mentioned earlier, many of the folks I used to work with use a financing strategy that's sort of just leave it to chance. You cross your fingers, you hope that folks have reserves, and when you get to that point in the conversation, you just really have a lot of hope and faith that they're going to be able to come up with the funds to pay for it. And I think obviously that's the wrong move. It hasn't worked for people. It makes people go out and do a lot of free work that doesn't make them any money, which is hard for businesses that are trying to grow and thrive. And I think when it comes to really significant scopes and large C&I facilities, the likelihood that your clients can easily and want to fund these types of projects is probably pretty low. So I'll take a little deviation from the question that I was asked about how. To tell you guys a little bit about something that I experienced here at Noesis, which I wasn't sort of familiar with in my previous life. But last year I worked on an energy efficiency finance cheat sheet that we distributed to the energy professionals in our community. And over the year, it's been a year plus since we launched it, I followed up with people, and as we've sort of mailed it around in different initiatives, I've had an opportunity to talk with folks about whether it was really useful to them, because the intention was that they would have sort of a reference guide that they could keep at their desk to answer questions about types of efficiency finance as it came up in conversations with building owners. And I mean, really, honestly, I was completely shocked about the number of responses that I got. A, because, you know, a lot of times when people receive a deliverable, they don't really want to engage with you about how they used it or whether it was helpful to them. But I got a lot of feedback, not only from people about how it was useful, but also about how frustrated they are about the lack of energy efficiency finance educational materials that are available out there. Most people I spoke to said that they don't offer financing because they don't feel comfortable speaking about it. They don't feel like they are domain experts in financing. It makes it very difficult for them to feel comfortable sort of getting into deeper dives with their customers about it. They also said that they don't have the tools or the resources and frankly the time to begin figuring out how to offer it. And so a lot of people said educational materials are a good start, but lots of people told me that they're working on learning as much about third-party financing as they can, you know, drips and drabs, a little bit at a time, reading articles here and there, to be as helpful to their clients as they can be moving forward. So it's always sort of the intent that in the future they will be domain experts in financing and they'll be able to offer those services to their clients. But frankly, you know, energy professionals are exactly that. They're energy professionals. They focus on learning about building science and energy math and modeling and, you know, different types of equipment and materials and facilities. That's their forte. And then conversely, the people that are making the financial decisions within facilities, they speak a completely different language. They're not thinking in decatherms and kilowatts. And, you know, you need to be able to speak the language that they are sort of making financial business decisions in. And that's frankly not a strong suit, at least in, you know, the folks that I've worked with in the past. And so that's really honestly why I'm really so thrilled about what Noesis is doing. There are companies out there that are built specifically to help bridge the information gap between efficiency and finance expertise. And companies like us are designed to take on the role of the financing department and handle sort of our customers 100% of their financing needs. And that really allows them to focus on their specialty and focus on being energy professionals. So I think the bottom line for me is that you don't need to continue to sort of burn the midnight oil and try to get your sort of MBA in efficiency financing by scouring the web for different resources. All you really need is a partner who knows what they're doing and has the expertise to help you ensure that you never lose another deal due to financing again. Hi, what would you say?
Yeah, I think, you know, again, Tanya, you make some great points, and a lot of times what I tell our customers is efficiency financing is a full-time job. It's my full-time job. So just doing it part-time can present a challenge. And so, you know, you certainly have options of you can hire your own staff to become those experts. You can make a relationship with a bank or maybe even a couple of banks. You can potentially use your own balance sheet to do financing, however you want to do it. I highly recommend that you don't use your own balance sheet to do financing, by the way. So you take a lot of credit risk and you can only scale so far that way. But there's a number of ways. The main point is you have to do it. It's time consuming, but you can't not afford to do it. This is the way the industry is going. Everyone's going to be including financing in their proposals pretty soon, and if you don't, you're going to be behind the eight ball. And just as Taino was saying, it's important to have someone who's knowledgeable there. Don't just leave it to your customers and say, well, you can get financing if you want, because they won't go out and look for financing for themselves. They don't have the time to deal with it. And as this industry expands, and there's becoming more options, it's not making it any easier. So there's becoming more and better options, which is certainly making it easier to match financing to a good financing vehicle, but it's just adding that much more complexity to know which financing vehicle you need to attach financing to. It's not the industry is not going to settle on one type of financing vehicle. It's just going to keep expanding and getting more complicated, but in the long run, that's going to be better for our customers.
Thanks a lot, Hai, and thanks a lot, Taina, for providing that color commentary. And just kind of in closing on that, I mean, what we see out there is that the real growth opportunity in this market is not replacing the boiler when it's broken or replacing the chiller when it's broken. It is providing these CFOs and building owners with opportunistic investments that are cash flow positive. And when you do that, these are opportunistic and they're unplanned, and chances are they're not budgeted. And so being able to go in there and make your business case for why they need to do it, they'll be nodding and they'll be looking at the financial metrics and they'll be looking at the ROIs and they'll be saying, this looks like an incredible investment, but I just don't have the money. And so if you want to close more deals, you have to give them a way to get the money, and financing provides them an opportunity to invest in a project that's unbudgeted and realize the benefits of that project. So again, financing will increasingly be the way that a lot of these opportunistic efficiency investments get done, and you know, quite frankly, we want to help you do that. So real quickly on Noesis Financing Services, I won't spend too much time going into the full pitch. We kind of went through this in the beginning, the two real reasons why projects are getting approved: no budget, and the second one, which I didn't cover earlier, is kind of lack of understanding or lack of trust in the savings estimates. And so, you know, we alluded to this several times throughout the presentation, but what Noesis offers through Noesis Financing Services is basically a service that allows you to attach financing to all of your proposals. And so we do that through a combination of our online tools for doing estimates, for doing loan quotes, to doing business proposals, which include all the information and cash flow analysis that CFOs want, as well as a team of project financing experts who are here, including a high who's on the team. And so what we do is we help you with kind of the business side of the proposal. So we help you with the business case, we attach the financing, we pitch the financing with you to the building owner to make sure that you maximize your chances of getting the deal closed. And then if they agree to do financing, we'll kind of handle everything after that. And so you can spend your time out there on existing customers, finding new prospects, and developing new business. And so it's not on the slide here, but the price, which most people ask about, is it's the entry level is $2,000 for your company per year, and that gives you unlimited access to the tools, and that's for unlimited users for the tools, unlimited quotes and estimates, unlimited proposals. We'll give you access to a range of financing vehicles, and so from PACE to, you know, basic leases to the sort of commercial performance contracts that Hai mentioned, the efficiency performance lease, as well as the shared savings agreement. We're going to work with you to come up with analyses that are cash flow positive from day one, which CFOs and building owners tend to look for. The application process is really quick. If someone interested, we can really turn that around and get the project funded and get you your money as quickly as possible. Expert support, like I mentioned, Hai, who has been doing this for a while and who's absolutely fantastic at it, is here, and as well as others who can help out. And so really what we're all about is helping you get more projects approved. And so if you think you might be interested, I'm going to put up a poll real quickly to kind of just ask whether or not you're interested. If you want more information on Noesis Financing Services, we will get in touch with you. If you don't, just say no, and we won't bug you. With that, and you guys can do the poll, and I'm going to just kind of look through the questions that are coming in, and we'll get those. Here's one, and it's a great one, which is, can a building owner deal directly with Noesis to evaluate financing options? And so let me hand that off to Ahai, who does this every day. Ahai?
Yes, certainly. So we'd be more than happy to work directly with the building owner. So a lot of our customers are contractors, but we also work with a number of building owners. And what we do is we help validate any information that they've gotten from their contractors, and then put financing packages together and working with our finance partners to help make sure that the funds are there to do the project. So there's absolutely no problem with doing that.
Yeah, and if you are, if you're a contractor efficiency company out there and you're using Noesis, and you want us to work with the building owner directly, I mean, that is actually part of our process, because we don't want to burden you with having to understand, explain, and answer all the questions with regards to financing. And so we'll do it. And so we'll be on the call with you. We'll explain it as your partner. One thing that we didn't really talk about, but adding financing is a huge competitive advantage for your business. A lot of people aren't doing it. Most people aren't doing it. And so if it's a competitive bid situation and you're the one that's providing options for third-party financing and providing a financing expert that can walk the building owner through it, you're going to be in a better position. And so it's a huge competitive advantage to be able to provide third-party financing on your proposals. Let's see. It says, does financing typically include soft costs? And the answer is, not surprisingly, it depends. But on most vehicles, soft costs can be included. Different vehicles have different thresholds about how much soft costs can be included. The number we typically see out there is like 30%. And so if it's around 30% that are soft costs, then those can be rolled into the financing vehicle as well. Leases typically cover 100%. If you're looking at a bank loan, they're not gonna cover. They won't cover the full cost of the equipment typically, and they tend to be a little bit harder to get to cover soft costs. How long does it take to finance a project? I'll kick this one over to you.
The short answer is very quickly. So it kind of depends on the size, but in a good majority of the cases, we can actually get approvals done within a couple of hours in some cases. Like I had a customer approved for $250,000 in 2 hours a couple weeks ago. So for smaller projects, we can do it with a one-page application. It's no problem to fill out. And then larger projects take a little bit longer time since a little bit more financial due diligence has to be done. But all the financing that we do is based on its equipment leases. So there's no need to take a lien on the building or anything like that. It's always done on the equipment. So unlike a bank that may take a couple of months to decide on financing, we can do it within a matter of hours to a matter of days.
Great, thanks, Ahai. Let me just see. We always see a lot of questions about PACE, and that team seems to be something that people read about or hear it mentioned in articles, and so we always get questions about what it is. I'll take a stab at sort of a brief description. So PACE is Property Assessed Clean Energy. And really what it is it's a way to finance an efficiency project where the lien is going to be on the building itself. It's going to be a property tax lien, and so it's actually a more senior claim to the building than the mortgage holder, which sort of is another challenge sometimes. But what it means is that and oftentimes you see this with situations where buildings change hands a lot, and that people want to make sure that they're not paying off some note that they did on some equipment on a building that they've long since sold. And so what happens is the loan, if you will, actually goes with the building and not the building owner, and so it's paid as part of the property tax. So it allows whoever goes and buys the building, they will then take on that payment stream. So again, it's kind of a clean way
to do these efficiency investments, finance them in a situation where the building may change hands in the next couple of years. The way that it's being rolled out, it's kind of region by region, and so PACE legislation has to be passed in order for it to be available to you. But if you have any other questions on that, we can certainly help out. Again, whether or not you're in a region or if you want some help putting together PACE financing for one of your projects, we can help out on that. So that brings us to the top of the hour. We did have some questions in here that we weren't able to answer, so we'll make sure we get all those questions answered, and we're going to send those out to all the folks who attended. I thank you very much for sitting through the webinar. We hope it was useful. If you have any questions, please feel free to email any one of us. Thank you, Taina and Ahai, for joining me. And again, we are thankful for you guys, and we hope to see you on another webinar. Thanks a lot.